get up and I recite a poem that my wife wrote. So this month, I have no talent. I can't sing, I don't dance, so, but I had to do something. So I'm going to tell you stories about assumptions. Maybe we'll learn something about assumptions. I'll give you an example of an assumption. A woman met a friend who was recently widowed as she was walking down the street, and the widow confessed that she realized that her husband really didn't love her very much. And the friend was surprised, and she said, "Well, look at you, that beautiful diamond." And she said, "Yes, this is a result of Harold. In his will, he left $30,000, $10,000 for the burial, and $20,000 for the stone. And this is the stone." So Harold made an assumption. Ron might be familiar with this type of assumption, that there was a pair of hunters were taken into the deep into the woods in Canada to hunt moose. And they fly into a lake, and the pilot leaves them off, and then a week later he comes back. And when he came back, here these guys were, and they had two moose apiece. So the pilot looks at these pile of moose, and he says, "You can't put those moose in this plane. It won't take off." And the fellas said, "Well, the pilot last year let us put four moose in a plane that was this size." So the guy said, "All right, I guess he did it, I guess I can do it." They load the moose on the plane, take off down the lake, and they just get up over the trees, and bang, they ran smack into a mountain. When they wake up, the one hunter looks to the other one and says, "Where are we?" And the guy said, "About 2 miles to the left of where we were last year." One more story about assumptions, and since this is a religious gathering, this will be a religious story. In the Middle Ages, there was a pope who decided that it was unseemly that there be a large Jewish population in Rome. So he said, he made an edict, and he said, "The Jews have got to leave Rome." Now this upset the Jews, so they went in a delegation to the pope to appeal this ruling. The pope was a fair man, so he said, "All right, we'll have a debate, and if your debater can defeat me, you can stay. And I'll be the judge of the debate, and one other thing is, we'll do the debate in mine." So the Jews went back to the synagogue, and he said, "What choice do we have? We have to do it." So they said, "Who will debate the pope in mine?" Not one rabbi would do it. And they were arguing back and forth, and finally the janitor walked by and went in, and he said, "What are you guys arguing about?" And they explained the problem to him, and he said, "Well, I'll do it." And they said, "You? What do you know about theology? The pope's the greatest theologian in living, and he'll just wipe you out." He said, "Oh, I'll do it." So the day of the debate comes, and there's the pope sitting on his throne. He's got 58 cardinals behind him and 200 bishops surrounding him, and here comes 11 Jewish rabbis and one janitor. And they go up to the debate, and the pope starts by saying, and the janitor goes, the pope begins to perspire. So then the pope goes, and just like this, the janitor goes, and the pope is really sweating. So he reaches in his cassock, and he pulls out an apple. And immediately, the janitor reaches in his bag, and he pulls out a matzah. And the pope says, "That's it. The Jews win, they can stay." And everybody, oh, you know, and then everybody leaves, and the cardinals and the bishops gather around, they say, Your Excellency, that speech was so rapid, that debate, the repartee was so rapid, we couldn't follow it. Could you explain to us exactly what happened?" He said, "Oh, the man, I don't know where they got him, he's a grand theologian." He said, "First of all, I reminded him that there was one God who covered all of the earth. And he immediately pointed downward to remind me that there was a hell. I began to be worried. But then I said, there is only one God. And he said, citing our own theology, but there is the Trinity. nothing to do, so I reached in my pocket, pulled out an apple to show him that some newfangled thinkers thought the world was round. And immediately, he pulled out a demonstration to prove in the Bible that the world was flat. What else could I do? He won. So the rabbis were talking to the janitor, and he said, "What happened? How did you do that? That was wonderful." He said, "Well, the Pope, no big deal. The first thing he says, he raises his hand and tells the Jews to get out of Rome." I said, "No, we're staying." Second thing he says is, "You've caused me one lot of trouble." And I said, "Hip, you've been thrice as much trouble to us." And the next thing he does is he takes out his lunch, so I took out mine.
Way. church and you have any children, you're not into other groups. And so the church has made me my friend. And so, but I thought of especially of, then I looked up and saw Mary and I said, don't, and then I have to always include Judy. And my club friends back there, I wanted to do something special for Dolph, but they're chicken. So, bear with me. The gift of friendship, and I think this is a poem we've all had on the cards or saw, but I thought it was very appropriate. Friendship is a priceless gift that cannot be bought or sold, but its value is far greater than a mountain made of gold. For gold is cold and lifeless. It can neither see nor hear, and in a time of trouble, it's powerless to cheer. It has no ears to listen, no heart to understand. It cannot bring you comfort or reach out a helping hand. So when you ask God for a gift, be thankful as he sends. Not diamonds, pearls, or riches, but the love of real, true friends. And I think there's a lot of them here tonight.
Yeah. looking forward to the next bend in the road. I'm not looking back with despair at the dead end I once chose. Although the end of my journey is not visible and side streets distract me, there are signs that point the way. Sometimes I find straight paths, sometimes they are jagged. Traffic slows me down and pedestrians get in my way. For a time I'm in a hurry, other times I go slowly. Often my road is made of dirt, but sometimes it is paved. I pass hitchhikers. Every once in a while I lend a hand. Who knows when the end of the road will come or what lies ahead.
Molly Stewart probably has been studying maybe for 13 years to play the clarinet, but it's probably been longer than that since I've actually played this thing. So I want you to bear with me. It's something we more or less decided to do on the spur of the moment. We are very, very blessed to have such a wonderful daughter, and I can't say enough about her. So I'm just going to play a song that I know that she likes real well, and truly she has been what the title of this song says to her mother and I. She really has been the person that lights up our life. Too, and when it was my wife's birthday month, it was January, you know, it was the first month, you know, and I wanted to do something for her too, but I didn't have the guts nor the time. Okay? So this song here I'm going to play as I remember it, whether it's right or wrong, and I don't have any music for it, so bear with me, okay?
Thank you.
Both my sister-in-law's had Gia's birthdays are this month. Janice and Susan and Lova and just everybody. And this is just a poem kind of about our best friend, Jesus. It's called The Legend of the Spider and the Silken Strand Held in God's Hand. There's an old Danish legend with a lesson for us all of an ambitious spider in his rise and his fall, who wove his sheer web with intricate care as it hung suspended somewhere in midair. Then, in soft, idle luxury, he feasted each day on the small, foolish insects he enticed as his prey. Growing ever more arrogant and smug all the while, he lived like a king in self-satisfied style. And gazing one day at the sheer strand suspended, he said, "I don't need this." So he recklessly rended the strand that had held his web in its place. And with sudden swiftness, the web crumbled in space. And that was the end of the spider who grew so arrogantly proud that he no longer knew that it was the strand that reached down from above, like the cord of God's grace and his infinite love, that links our lives to the great unknown, for man cannot live or exist on his own. And this old legend, with simplicity told, is a moral as true as the legend is old. Don't sever the lifeline that links you to the Father in heaven who cares for you too.
You'll see what I mean momentarily. Okay, getting my sisters up here is nothing short of a miracle. Nothing could have been a bigger surprise.
Thank you.
think Rudolph